Good morning to all of you here. Welcome to Old Donation Church, both here, those of you who are in person, but also those of you who are with us online on Facebook and later today on YouTube. It is a blessing to see all of you on this day. It is the Sunday closest to the Feast of St. Francis, and so we have a little, we'll say the prayer of St. Francis at some point, but we will also do something unusual that you haven't seen in a while, but Ashley and I are going to begin this week with a four-week series of preaching on the book of Job. So it is our Old Testament reading for this Sunday and the next three. And so we're going to do something a little different and preach on Job every Sunday. So I think you'll have fun with that. We're going to do it in our conversational style that we use sometimes. So without further ado, we will begin our worship. Please stand or sit at home, and we're going to sing Morning Has Broken.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Together let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Most high, omnipotent, good Lord, grant your people grace to renounce gladly the vanities of this world, that following the way of Blessed Francis, we may, for love of you, delight in your whole creation with perfectness of joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated and settle in for our first reading of Scripture.
There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. One day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them to present himself before the Lord. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. He still persists in his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him for no reason." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Skin for skin, all that people have, they will give to save their lives. But stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, he is in your power. Only spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and inflicted loathsome sores on Job, from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. Job took a potsherd with which to scrape himself and sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still persist in your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as a foolish woman whose fate. Shall we receive the good at the hand of God and not receive the bad?" And all this Job did not sin with his lips. The word of the Lord.
Stand and join in singing our sequence hymn, "What Wondrous Love Is This?"
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. People were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Send your word that we may hear it with our ears, plant it in our hearts where it may take root and grow, and let it strengthen our weak knees that we may have courage to follow Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. So we're going to talk about Job this month.
We are.
Job is often referenced. We talk about the bad luck of Job. We talk about
the patience of Job.
The patience of Job, which we're going to learn he's not really patient the way we understand. But Job is often referenced but seldom studied or preached on. And so we want to do a deep dive into Job because the issues that we find in the book of Job are the ones that every one of us deals with at some point in our lives or points over and over again sometimes. The issues of suffering.
Right. We get to address all of those big questions that we all ask and have. What does God have to do with suffering? When we look out in this world and we don't like what we see and it doesn't seem fair, we say, God, how could you do this?
Or how could you allow this?
Right. How could you allow this to happen? Are you even there? Is God even there? Does God even care about what happens
right.
to us?
If in fact God is good, which mm-hmm. we say all the time,
right.
and God is in control and has all of us in the palm of his hand, as Scripture tells us, then why in the world does the world seem to work contrary to what God wishes? Or at least what Scripture tells us.
Right. So it gets really uncomfortable. And it's going to be uncomfortable, but we are used to that, or should be, because there's a lot of our scripture that makes us uncomfortable, makes us ask questions about, you know, do I really believe that God did this? What does this say about God, about me, about humanity?
Or do I even believe that there's a God, period?
Right.
These are all the questions that the suffering in our world will bring to the forefront. Sometimes we don't want to speak those words, but most of us at some point in life say, is God real or mm-hmm. not? If God is real, is God good? If God is real and good, is he impotent or does he just not care?
Right. So the first question we have to ask then is, how do we read the book of Job?
Yeah, it's an interesting book because if you Google who wrote Job and who's it about and whatnot, you can find 15 different answers. Job was a man who lived in the 5th century BC, or he's a man in the exile, or it's an ancient legend. It's possible that Job is about a real person who had an incredible string of bad luck. And the legends grew and grew about him, but it's also true that when you read the book, it doesn't read like history at all.
Right. This isn't like the book of Kings or Chronicles. It doesn't tell the story of David or Solomon or even the book of Acts that we read in the New Testament
right.
that tells about what the disciples have done. This is what we refer to as narrative theology. Mm-hmm. So what that means is that it is a story comprised of likely a historical figure or events that have happened or could happen, but that tells something about God and about what we believe God to be,
right.
who we believe God to be, and how God relates to us.
So there's no real point in doing an archaeological discovery session to go out there and try to figure out where Job was, because that's missing the point.
Right.
The point is, when you read it closely, there may be basis on history, but the truth is, these speeches have been developed over time into a theological set of choruses and speeches, poetry and prose, that help us to understand what the writer of the book of Job wants us to know about God, about us, about suffering, about our response, and about God's care and concern for this world.
So it's like a big, long drama. There's prose and poetry mixed in, and it is very dramatic.
Yes.
Shakespeare probably took some pointers in writing his plays from the book of Job.
Yes, you can imagine Macduff and Macbeth being in these sort of same situations, and you see when a whole long, long, long speech is made by one of Job's friends or Job's wife or God or Job himself, you see this drama, and it is really good drama. It's so good, I'm kind of shocked that Netflix hasn't taken it up yet, right? Except I was thinking about this. It might well be that the reason they haven't taken it up is Job has more questions than concrete answers.
Yes, we never like when our television series just make us ask more and more questions and don't ever solve anything for
That's
us.
That's right.
So
yeah,
probably don't want to turn Job into a TV show.
Yeah, if the mysteries always remain unsolved, we would be pretty dissatisfied with the show. And yet, Job will give us some real answers, but it won't necessarily be tied up in nice little bows. Mm-hmm. So as we study it, it's going to be an interesting thing. So maybe tell me, where does today's scripture start?
Yeah,
what's going on?
We want to set the stage. So that's what this opening passage in the book of Job does, is it sets the stage for what's to come and lays out some of the basic theological arguments that the book is going to make as we go forward.
Right, right.
So here we have God, who is sitting up in heaven on his throne, and all of the heavenly hosts are coming, and he's entertaining them, and he's listening to them, and Satan comes along and joins them.
Yeah.
And this is the second time this group has gathered, because the first time Satan came along and had a very similar conversation where God allowed him to afflict evil and suffering on Job through his possessions and his loved ones, and so his sons and his daughters and his crops and his cattle and
But
all.
He didn't lose everything.
He did not lose everything.
Didn't lose everything. We'll talk a little bit about that too. But Job is the subject of this discussion among God's heavenly council, who say, Satan says, you know, people don't really do what you want because they love you. They do it because you keep blessing them and throwing blessings one on top of another. What if your best guy, what if Job, who you claim has integrity and will always do the right thing, what if I just took everything away? I'm willing to bet that it won't happen, because Satan is not the guy with the pitchfork in Job. Right. Satan is a member of God's council, but he's sort of like the great cynic. He's sort of like a prosecuting attorney, okay? apologies to the lawyers that we've got in the congregation, but he's like the one who comes and punches holes in God's argument all the time and says, let me check this out. You think this is the way it works? I'm going to prove to you it didn't work the way you designed it. And that's the kind of person Satan is. And he says, you love Job, you claim Job loves you, but I'll tell you, it doesn't work that way. Let me keep doing things, taking stuff away.
So here we have Satan saying, okay, we'll take his things away, fine, but if you afflict his body himself, then he's going to curse you.
He's going to give in. I can see him wavering right now, is what Satan says.
Right.
And we see God say, okay, go ahead. Do what you want with Job. Just don't take his life. But does that sound like the God that we care about? Does that sound like a God who loves Job? Not at all. It's unfair. It's not right. And this is why whenever you see things in Scripture that just don't look right, you start to pay closer attention. Because the book of Job is setting up one of the most important, the crux of God's idea for creation. And that is why God has to take the bet.
Right, because it's actually Satan here who is helping to illustrate the main theological argument, which is God's point and perspective, that our relationship with God, humanity's relationship with God, is based not upon the blessings that God gives, which allows us to love God,
right,
but about this covenantal relationship where, because God loves us and we love God, even when bad things happen, that loving relationship still continues. And that's what God believes in, and that's what Satan is saying is false.
That's right. It's the same issue in godly relationships of friends or marriages. It's not just that you do for each other when things are going well. It's when things are going bad that it really gets put to the test. And Satan is saying, put Job to the test, and I guarantee he will not be faithful. And it really comes down to the most important question about God's design, because he says, it's all about my covenant that I make with people. You will be my people, I will be your God. We will love one another. We will be on this journey together. And that's the way it's been all the way from the beginning. Job puts it to the test because the Satan says, I don't believe it's true. So it comes down to this question. And so God says, have your way. Take your best shot.
Yep.
And then we see what happens.
That's right. So in the next couple of weeks, what we'll be doing is looking at how this theological argument that is being set up here plays out. What happens? How do Job's friends respond? How does Job's wife respond? We heard a little bit about what Job's wife says today.
Her answer, you read, right, today? You heard when Stu read it? Job has now been inflicted with sores from his head to his toe. He sits and he scrapes them all off and he sits in the ashes. You imagine that. As bad as it can get, he's just sitting in the ashes of his own skin. And his wife comes by and she doesn't say, oh, Job, I feel so sorry for you. She says, screw your integrity. Curse God and die. It would be better than what you're doing. Give it up. God is not good to you. Don't be good back to God. St. John of Chrysostom, some of you know, he's got a famous prayer in our morning prayer service about when two or three have gathered together. We love Chrysostom. But he also, he wrote a commentary on Job. He said, the biggest trial that Job faces is that Satan did not take his wife. We're going to see as we go through this how helpful are Job's wife and friends. What is their advice? How do they provide spiritual counsel? How do they provide comfort and challenge? And do any of them get it right?
And what can we then learn about our relationship with one another, with God, how we respond when bad things happen, and how this can help to change our perspective or just learn more about this life that we're living and this God we're loving?
Because as I said earlier, every one of us goes through times like Job. Every one of us faces challenges where we wish we could understand what in the world is God doing, where things don't go the way they're supposed to go. Job's going to help us on that journey. Amen.
Amen.
Now we'll continue with the prayers of the people. So please stand if you're here and settle in for some prayers. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ Church and the world. Let us pray for the church, for this parish, its mission and ministry, its clergy and people, for God's people throughout the world, for Susan, our bishop, and all bishops and other ministers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all in authority of government in this and every land. We ask your guiding hand to lead our President Joe, Congress, and all in authority in the pursuit of the common good for all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray for peace, for healing for those on our parish prayer list. We pray for those who have died. I invite your petitions and thanksgiving silently or aloud. We pray especially for those on our parish prayer list, particularly those who are in the hospital or in distress. We lift up particularly Bruce Sturzing, Jean Wood, Ruth Ann Campbell. Pray for Susan's sister, Carol. We pray for those who are deployed around this world that are members of this parish family especially. We pray for peace in all lands. We pray for the people as refugees from Afghanistan, that they may find home and that it be welcoming. And we give thanks for the blessing of our pets and all those animals that continue to brighten our world. We ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us say together the prayer of St. Francis printed in your bulletin. Together, Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring love. Where there is offense, let me bring heart. Where there is discord, let me bring union. Where there is error, let me bring truth. Where there is doubt, let me bring faith. Where there is despair, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, let me bring your light. Where there is sadness, let me bring joy. O Master, let me seek as much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that one receives, it is in self-forgetting that one finds, it is in pardoning that one is pardoned, it is in dying that one is raised to eternal life. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. A word of welcome to all of you who are with us on this day. As we continue with the Holy Eucharist, I want to call special attention. Emeka is here, and looks like you have your family. And we have been praying for your family and for them to make it here all these years, and what a blessing it is. So thank you, thank you. Come from where? Nigeria, but where? In Lagos or where? Lagos. Okay. Welcome. We are overjoyed that you are here safely. So good. Okay. Walk in love. Oh, let me, one other announcement. Tonight at 5:50, right out here, we're going to have youth groups start. Middle school and high school students will gather for a meal. We'll do part of the program inside where we will need masks, but we'll do most of the program outside. But every week starting this day, we will have youth group at 5:50 until 7:15. Okay, so that's our schedule beginning this week. Okay, so if you have kids at home and Chloe's here, that's good. Come and join us if you like, and join us for youth group. That'll be every week, every Sunday night. Okay, so after Sunday's at 5 service, 5:50. Walk in love as Christ loved.
Probably want to announce for next week so people have a heads
up. Oh, yes, yes. Ah, very important, yes. Next Sunday is the annual feast of the parish of our founding in 1637. And so for our parish feast next Sunday, we are not going to hold the 11 o'clock service, not going to hold the 9:30 service. We're going to hold one service at 10:30, right in the middle. If it's nice weather, we will be outside. But we'll accommodate those of you who need special accommodation to get you up close to where you can see and participate. 10:30 next Sunday, just one time only, 10:30. So the stream service will happen at 11, just like it would normally, but our in-person services, 9:30 and 11, will happen as one service at 10:30, after which we will have a meal. Taste Unlimited is supplying box lunches for us all, and we will have a speaker from the diocese, and we'll kick off our stewardship as well. So all that will happen next Sunday. Come next Sunday, 10:30, not 11. If you come at 11, you'll just walk into the middle of the service, okay? Okay. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. She'll need the water and the wine.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. And so we join the saints and angels in proclaiming your glory as we sing. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, sanctify this bread and wine by your Holy Spirit, that they may be the body and blood of your Son. By means of this holy bread and cup, we show forth the sacrifice of his death and proclaim his resurrection until he comes again. Gather us by this holy communion into one body in your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith. With thanksgiving.
Thank you.
continuing with our post-communion prayer, let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Spirit of truth lead you into all truth, giving you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and to manifest in word and deed the liberating, loving, powerful works of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Amen.
To all of you who are with us this day, I wish you blessings, and we will see you again next week. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. See you soon. Whoa, what a blessing.